When it comes to selecting ECUs for an aftermarket engine management project, there's a wide range of options, and of course all of those options come with a vast range of price points. Now of course there's also different feature sets that go with those different ECUs, and this can be a little bit frustrating and confusing for the average enthusiast. Of course, the sort of ECU that we may choose for our streetcar project is going to be quite different to what we may want to choose for a high-end professional level of motorsport, but we've got Martin from BM Technik here to just talk us through some of those options and find out what we're actually getting for our money when we're laying down perhaps 10,000 plus US dollars for an ECU. So I guess, Martin, to start with, talking about the feature sets from an ECU, I think it's important to understand that when we're looking at a different ECU feature set, if we've got an ECU that lists that it has traction control, that doesn't necessarily mean that every traction control strategy works in the same way. Can you talk us through a little bit about the differences you see between different brands and how that transpires when you've actually got a car on a damp surface?
Well, one of the biggest differences between entry-level ECUs and high-performance ECUs is the one-box solution. You get much more packed into one device. The data logger sits on top of it, which is important to always know what the strategy does at each individual time, not just to get the raw data in sampled fast enough, but also what are the process steps in between. That is one major difference. Then just the complexity of embedded systems in a high performance ECU is by a factor of 100 different to more simpler ECUs.
Actually, you just mentioned there about data logging, and I think we'll come back to that traction control issue, but just because you've mentioned the data logging there, and again, this is an area where an ECU will say that it's got data logging capability, and on face value, that may seem to be enough. But of course, depending on what you're doing, you may need more channels, which takes up more memory, and also the speed that we're able to log different channels is really important. Can you tell us about sort of how that works out in professional motorsport and what you actually need?
Data logging systems, just the name data logging doesn't mean that the functionalities are identical. High performance ECUs nowadays are capable to log hundreds and hundreds of channels at a very high rate. So modern ECUs like a Crosworth ECU are capable to go up to 200 kilohertz nowadays. They can capture data in an aperiodic way. They can capture data very fast and very synchronous to each other. That's something a lower entry level ECU would not be capable of.
Now, you just mentioned 200,000 hertz. So what that means is you're able to capture a certain signal 200,000 times a second. Now, of course, you don't need to capture every signal going into the ECU at that speed. Some of the slower moving signals, such as perhaps air temperature and coolant temperature, probably we're quite capable of logging that at a low frequency, maybe 2 to 5 hertz. But of course, when you start looking at things like maybe in-cylinder pressure, this is something that's happening very fast. And to get that data in a useful format, this is where those frequencies are important.
Correct, absolutely. So there is things like damper movement, in-cylinder position sensors or cylinder pressure sensors, where having such a high weight is critical. Yes.
Now, just because we've talked about or mentioned there in-cylinder pressure, this is something that we again don't see at the entry level, club level, street level. It's just not something we use for tuning, but of course at professional motorsport levels and OE sort of levels, this is how the engines are calibrated. So normally this is a tool that's only used during the dyno session, and it's monitoring the actual pressure inside the combustion chamber so we can see exactly where peak cylinder pressure is occurring, helping us to optimize spark timing as well as make sure we can see if detonation or pre-ignition are occurring. But now some of these aftermarket ECUs at high-end are able to also do this on the fly, is this correct?
That is correct, yeah, absolutely. Even in a professional environment, I have to say it's not that easy to get the sensors or to get the business case and get it justified to have this equipment on board. The amplifiers and the sensors can be really expensive. Monitoring in 8-cylinder engines where you need 8 of them is it collects to a lot of money, but having access to these sensors is what you have is you have the final puzzle piece of being really closed loop. Normally, more or less, you you fire at a point where you think you should fire. You throw in an amount of fuel in which you think should be all right. You have sensors like the lambda sensors sitting behind it where you can have a bit of an idea of what happened, but having access to the pressure curve itself is something you actually see what is going on at which crank angle in position.
Now, for me, it's of interest there. If you've got this data on the dyno, that's one thing. As I've said, you can use that for calibration, which is fine. But if you've now got ECUs that have the ability to monitor this in real time on an eight-cylinder engine, for example, is it then possible to use strategies to provide essentially closed-loop control of the ignition timing? In other words, adjusting the timing on the fly as the engine's running to make sure that each cylinder is always achieving optimal timing?
That is possible. There is a lot of strategies which can be derived from having this information. There are strategies for basically engine wear detection. There are strategies for knock control. There are strategies to basically work out how equal balanced each cylinders are to each other. You can compensate for different fuels. There is a lot of compensation you can run of it. Actually having access to a closed loop real-time ignition control method is like the most sophisticated thing you can do. What it is in general, without going too much into detail, is basically equalizing the mass fraction burned points at a certain spot. So rather than having them jumping around and having effects like remaining exhaust within the cylinder, which affects the next cycle, you can compensate for these effects and always getting the optimum performance out of that moment.
Now, I think it's also worth mentioning here that the cost, which you've kind of touched on there, of the sensors and integrating those sensors into the engine, if you're sort of looking at applying that to your engine, probably the cost of the ECU is the least of your worries. So this, just so everyone viewing this is aware, this is a very expensive system to add to any engine. Now, just talking about some of the other strategies there, when you're talking about an ECU that is used at the highest levels of motorsport, perhaps LMP1, LMP2, for example, what sort of strategies are being used there that we don't see at sort of club level motorsport that can be useful to getting the last little bit of performance out of an engine and out of the chassis?
The complexity of the strategies is big nowadays compared to where they are 10, 15 years ago. As I mentioned before, having a single box solution where one ECU is running not just the fueling and the ignition, but traction control, knock control, transmission control, pit lane limit control, full course yellow control, the logging, everything which is logged. External displays are driven off ECUs nowadays as well. They're just sitting there as a satellite remote display. So rather than configuring the display all with a display setup, the ECU does all that work. There is a lot going on within a single device. There's thousands of parameters, thousands of channels. If you want to hear about an example talking about, I think you mentioned traction control earlier, where simple traction control is only more or less looking at a percentage or an absolute comparison of the undriven and the driven wheel speeds. Things like grip estimation can be added, where you're actually forecasting the grip levels under certain conditions, in combination with using different pedal maps. So basically, the translation between your pedal sensor and the fly-by-wire actuators sitting on the front of the engine. It's so much linked into each other. You wouldn't find this on an entry-level device.
So it sounds to me like you're talking more about sort of preemptive or predictive traction control rather than actually dealing with the situation once the car is wheel spinning. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct. Yep.
And of course, if you can keep the car hooked up and keep traction, it's going to make the car easier for the driver to control. And when we're not wheel spinning, you're able to get maximum acceleration. Is that fair to say?
Yes, so maximum acceleration is one of the reasons why you would edit, but also in general, I always look at the traction control as a performance item, but also as a health insurance. We're doing a lot of work in the endurance racing, and with endurance racing, if you think about being at Nürburgring 24 hour at 4 o'clock in the morning, doing a triple stint, you want something which always does the job when you're then coming into slippy, greasy, raining conditions, you want something which reacts very quick, helps you under in every situation. Having something which where just the sudden change of the wheel speed error, what in a PID loop the D-turn would help you with, everything is tuned to perfection and would help you under these conditions.
Look, Martin, been great to get some insight into what goes into an ECU at that price point, and hopefully that's given us, our viewers at least, a little bit more of an idea of why these ECUs are priced at that level. Obviously, not suitable for every application, but if you've got a pretty big checkbook and you're racing at those levels, it's going to give you an advantage. Now, if people want to reach out and find out more about you and your company, where can they go to?
That would be bmracetech.de or martin@bmracetech.de. I'm more than happy to answer questions and to help with any inquiries.
Perfect. Thanks a lot for the chat.
Thank you. No problem.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.